In this video, we're going to review the techniques of integration that we've learned so far and try to come up with a general strategy, or at least some guidelines. So, what we've learned so far, we might need to do some kind of algebra or trigonometry to simplify the integrand before we start to look for the antiderivative. We should always rely on our change of variables, and sometimes we have to be creative with the selection for our change of variables. If the integrand is the product of powers of trig functions, then we might try to use our trig identities. If we have a rational function that's a polynomial divided by another polynomial, we might want to try partial fractions. And if I have a polynomial multiplied by a transcendental function, meaning an exponential function or a trig function, we might try integration by parts. I guess I should put an S on that. And if we have a function with a radical, we might be looking at either a U substitution or a trig substitution. It's not really clear. And the whole idea is to not give up. If you start down one path, it may not lead you somewhere. We should try again. If you started with a U substitution, try a different U substitution. If you didn't think of trying a U substitution, go ahead and try one. Get creative. Try integration by parts. Even if it doesn't look like a product, well, maybe after making a U substitution, it'll look like a product. Or maybe you just have to have, dV equals dx. Or maybe the way it's written, there are many ways you could choose U and dV, and you got to try different choices. You might try multiplying the integrand by a form of 1. So think about cases where you want to multiply top and bottom by the conjugate. Or relate it to a previous problem. Maybe the integrand looks like a familiar derivative. So let's work through several examples where we make use of these various techniques. So in this first example, I see sine of phi over cosine cubed of phi. Now this is a ratio rather than a product. So I'm going to see if I can't rewrite this in terms of the other trig functions. So I could write cosine cubed of phi as cosine phi times cosine squared phi. And I see that sine of phi over cosine of phi, that's tangent of phi. 1 over cosine squared of phi is secant squared of phi. And now I can just make a simple U substitution where U equals tangent of phi and du is secant squared phi d phi. So that just becomes the integral of U du, which is half U squared plus C. And I rewrite in the answer in the original variable to get 1/2 tan squared phi plus C. So what did we do here? We simplified the integrand and we used a U substitution. Right, in our second example, we have 2 arctan of radical x. So now certainly, I know the derivative of arctan. I don't know its antiderivative, and then on the inside, I have a radical x. So these inverse trig functions, it can be difficult to work with them. So one thing I always try is to make a substitution to go back to the original trig function. So if u equals arctan of radical x, then tangent of u equals radical x, so x equals tangent squared of u, and dx would be 2 tangent of u secant squared u du. And when I put that in my integral, I see that I have a bunch of products here. I mean, I'm going to have to use integration by parts. I have u times, some transcendental functions. And since I'm going to use integration by parts, you can see that I'd rather use y rather than u. And in fact, I can see that here I was already thinking y. So let me make the change from u to y. And now let me continue. I'm going to integrate by parts. I'm going to have u equal 2y, so du is 2dy. I just put this part in here. This was my dx, so if I make that whole thing dv, then I know v has to be tangent squared of y. So here's my u times v minus v du. I just put the 2 out in front. To find the antiderivative tangent squared, I'm going to use a trig identity. And then now take the antiderivative. Antiderivative secant squared is just tangent. And now let me go back to my original variable. So y is arctan radical x. Tangent of y is radical x, so tangent squared will just be x. And where does that take me? This big expression here. So what do? We did a change of variables. I forgot. We also used a trig identity plus integration by parts and a trig identity. So we used three techniques there. Example three, here I have a power of cosine times sine, but it's sine of 2x. Well, fine. The double angle formula for sine is one of our most important identities. Let me take advantage of that. That would give me 2 sine x cosine x. And 2 sine x, so the 2 I'm going to bring out in front. Cosine times cosine to the 5th gives me cosine to the 6th, and then I just have a sine of x. And now I can just make a u substitution. I can let u equal cosine of x, du is negative sine of x dx. And my bounds go, instead of from 0 to pi over 2, I'll go from 1 to 0. And now I just have u to the 6th du. And so I've got this negative sign because of the negative sine x dx for du. And I also have my bounds kind of out of order. I have the smaller bound on top and the larger bound on the bottom. So I'm going to swap the bounds, and that will change the sign to be a positive 2 outside the integral. And just use the power rule and perform the evaluation. So what did we do? We did a trig identity followed by change of variables, a u substitution. Right here, I have a polynomial divided by a polynomial, and in fact, I can see that the degree of the top is smaller than the degree of the bottom. So let's see if I can factor the denominator, and I sure can. So I'll go ahead and find the partial fraction expansion or partial fractions decomposition of the integrand. So I'll start. I know I have 3 terms. Let me go ahead and multiply both sides of that by the least common denominator. And then I'll just get a system of equations by setting the corresponding coefficients equal to each other. So I have an ax squared plus bx squared. So a plus b has to equal 9. I have 2ax, bx, and cx, so 2a plus b plus c equals 13, and then for the constant, 5 has to equal a. So once I know a, I can just immediately find b to be 4, and I know a and b, so put those into the second equation, that gets me c equals negative 1. So now I just have to find the integral of these 3 terms. The first one is just going to be natural log of the absolute value of x. The second one, we have 5 times the natural log of absolute. 4 times the natural log of the absolute value of x plus 1. And so let me just think about this third one a little bit. If I make a u substitution where u equals x plus 1, du equals dx. So I'm really finding the antiderivative of u to the negative 2 power, and that's just going to be negative u to the negative 1 power plus c, or negative 1 over x plus 1. So my antiderivative then is 5 natural log times the absolute, no, not times, 5 times the natural log of the absolute value of x plus 4 times the natural log of absolute value of x plus 1 plus now, remember it was minus, but now I had a minus sign over here. So minus a minus makes a plus 1 over x plus 1 plus c. So what did we use? We used partial fractions and a change of variables just for one of the terms there. All right, so example 5, whoa, that's too many steps at once. Let's slow this down. Okay, so here I have t times e to the radical t. So it looks like I'm eventually going to use integration by parts, but I can't use it right away. I can't find the antiderivative of e to the radical t. So let's make a change of variables. Let's let y equal radical t. So then y squared equals t, and dt is 2y dy. So when I write this integral in terms of y, well, t is y squared, and I have e to the y, and then times 2y dy. That's what dt is. Or that's 2y cubed e to the y dy. So now we got to use integration by parts, and probably multiple times because I've got y cubed here. So it's going to be pretty much the same, so I won't take too much time going through this. In the first integration by parts, u will equal 2y cubed, du then is 6y squared, dv is always going to be e to the y dy. So v equals e to the y. So here I have my u v minus integrand minus integral v du. And now let's use parts again. U equals 6y squared. Du equals 12y. Dv is going to be the e to the y dy as it was before. And now let's go ahead and use our formula with our new uv minus the new vdu. And integration by parts is needed one last time. And finally, I can just find the antiderivative of 12 e to the y dy. It's just 12 e to the y. And so I found my final antiderivative here using, should also go back to the original variable t. Sorry about that. Now I've got the antiderivative in terms of the original variable, and I had to use a change of variables followed by multiple steps of integration by parts. This is a very challenging antiderivative, and it really teaches us the lesson that even when it looks like a method is not going anywhere, sometimes we should just have some patience and persistence and see where it takes us. So first thing I would do here is write this as two integrals. And at this point, people may give up because they may say, well, I should know that there is no way to express the antiderivative of e to the x squared as any combination of elementary functions. But let's keep going. What I can do with the first integral is rewrite it so that I have, instead of 2x squared, I'm going to write that as x times 2x times e to the x squared power. And now now I'm going to do integration by parts just with the first integral. So I'm going to let u equal x, so du equals dx. dv is going to be 2x e to the x squared, and 2x e to the x squared is the integral of e to the x squared. So v would be e to the x squared. And so when I write u times v minus v du, look what happens. Sure, I can't calculate the integral of e to the x squared or find the antiderivative of e to the x squared, but I don't have to because I have a minus integral e to the x squared dx plus integral e to the x squared dx. So those add out. They add to make zero. So my antiderivative is just x e to the x squared plus c. So we used integration by parts with some persistence. In our last example here, I have 1 over 1 minus cosine of x, and it's not really clear how to proceed, but 1 minus cosine of x suggests that maybe I should try multiplying by a form of 1, the conjugate 1 plus cosine of x over itself. Now what does that do for me? Well, now I've got 1 plus cosine x on top, my over 1 minus cosine squared x on the bottom. Well, 1 minus cosine squared x is just sine squared x. And now I could write this as two separate fractions, 1 over sine squared x, which is just cosecant squared x, and then cosine over sine squared x. I'm going to write that as cosine of x over sine of x times sine of x. I think that I have over here really multiplied times 1. And why? Because then I would have, well, what is the, let me clear this off, we're not ready for this part yet. Then I would have cotangent of x times cosecant of x. So I know the antiderivative of cosecant squared, that is negative cotangent, and the antiderivative of cosecant x cotangent x is negative cosecant x. So what did we do here? We used multiplying by our form 1, and then we used some trig identities. So as you're working through these different integrals, keep in mind all of the different techniques, and I realize that it can be frustrating sometimes, but with some persistence, and if you keep trying the different methods and working through step by step carefully, you can find the antiderivative that you're looking for.